Welcome, everyone. I'm going to do this slightly in reverse order. To start off by thanking CUNY and the Sonic Arts Center, which offers a four-year Bachelor of Fine Arts degree in music with a concentration in music and audio technology. Their program provides an in-depth curriculum emphasizing real-world skills with a project-based approach. Students enjoy a well-rounded program with emphasis on audio technology, music theory, orchestration, and history to help them compete in a field that today demands an ever-growing and highly diverse skill set. And that is certainly true. And this is a meeting of the ARSC New York chapter. All of our meetings are free and open to the public, but donations are gleefully accepted. And to join ARSC, visit www.arsc-audio.org. Today's program, called Getting Back to the Source, or as close as possible, with Seth Winner. Seth will present an evening of audio examples of source material, including items in his personal collection that he has either remastered or preserved for the purpose of examining correct methods to retrieve such documents from media as diverse as pressings, metal parts, lacquer discs, original tapes, and in a number of instances, surviving tape copies from lacquer discs which otherwise have been lost. Featured artists to include Arturo Toscanini. What a surprise. Dimitri Mitropoulos, Oscar Levant, Giovanni Martinelli, Zinka Milanov, Lawrence Tibbett, and Jussi Bjo. Seth is currently engaged in a NARA-sponsored conservation and preservation project, New York Philharmonic World War II-era broadcast. He established Seth B. Winter Sound Studios in 1990. Included among his previous remastering clients are the New York Philharmonic, Minnesota Orchestra, Metropolitan Opera, Sony Music, Pavilion Records Limited, Crystal and Universal Records. He has earned three Grammy nominations and one honorable mention from NARIS. From 1996 to 2004, he was co-chair with Gary Galo of ARSC's technical committee and a contributor to the CLIR technical report concerning analog identification, conservation, and preservation. Recent preservation and remastering projects have been undertaken for the Cy Walter Archives, the Bach Aria Group, the Princeton Symphony Orchestra, and Mark Laycock, the Schnabel Family Foundation, the Benny Carter and Benny Goodman collections housed at the Rutgers University Institute of Jazz Studies, and a four CD package devoted to Jussi Bjerling's American radio broadcast published by the American JB Society on the WHRA label. And there it is. Since 1989, he has remastered the critically acclaimed Vocal Record Collector Society annual issues. As a sound engineer at the New York Public Library for almost 25 years, he has supervised the preservation of some collections as such collections as the Voice of America, the National Orchestral Association, the Little Orchestral Society, Roberta Peters, Henry Cowell, Vincent Persichetti, Otto Luning, and U.B. Blake. He has also been a technical curator of the Toscanini Collection since 1988. And when I was asked to do this, I said to myself, after 35 years of being good friends with Seth, I have to say something good about him.
Thank you.
Now cut that out.
I'll get back to you on that.
Now cut that out.
But seriously, there are few people I know as much about this subject as he does, and certainly few who know as much about lacquers transferring and all the other stuff that goes into this very niche market. So one more thing, February 20th, 2014 will be our next ARSC New York chapter meeting. In this room, it will be by Tom Fine, called Orchestral Recording from One Mic to Many. It's my pleasure to introduce Seth Winner.
I just want to get that on audio. As Jack Benny used to say, now cut that out. Anyway, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a happy and a healthy new year. By the way, this is one of the things you should never do, is put a paper clip near any of these lacquer discs. There are stories about index cards put on envelopes, and all of a sudden this falls right through and completely scratches the surface. There are a number of them in the NBC collection like that, so it goes over there for the moment. First off, I want to thank a couple of people, namely Joe Patridge, for introducing me, and my good friend Al Lazitsky, who I've known now, what is it now, 34 years close to it? Or is it 34 long, thanks a lot.
Wonderful years.
Terrific, yes. who is going to, because this is more than a one-man job in the sense of doing a show and tell and explaining what's going on. I asked Al to run the CD player for the audio examples. One of the things I don't like doing is doing a PowerPoint because of the fact of the amount of time it takes, and there's nothing like somebody coming up and actually looking at the artifact or the actual original source as opposed to seeing it on a screen. And the other reason why I don't want to do that tonight is the fact that this program is being recorded. This is one of four that will be recorded visually as well as audio, which will be sent to the National ARSC website for streaming to ARSC members down the road. They got to figure out once we send the files what's happening. So this could be the beginning of something rather exciting in the sense of actually, we may actually have video up of actual presentations before the National Conference ever does. Right, Mike? Okay. Well, anyway, today is January 16th. For those of you know what day it is. Does anybody know what anniversary is today? 57 years ago this morning, Toscanini died. So I felt it was appropriate to start this program with a prelude to Act One of Traviata, but I'm not going to tell you what the source is or where it's from. Al, could you play track one, please? any of you figure out what the source of this would be, judging from what you just heard? Okay, don't all yell at once.
It's definitely an 8H.
Nope.
It's not?
Nope. Joe, does it sound like a tape source, a disc source, what?
Well, it's pretty clean. I mean, I don't hear a lot of surface noise at all.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But it couldn't be Carnegie.
No. It's about 3,000 miles east of there.
It's in Europe?
Yep.
Philharmonia?
No, further east. Keep going.
I know.
Czech?
No.
La Scala?
Right. You got it, John. This, and in fact, it's not from tape. It's from this vinyl pressing, which my friend Jeff Lipton found on the internet and gifted to me to do a transfer of. This is as close to a source as you can get outside of getting a metal part. What you just heard was recorded on August 11, 1951 at Teatro Scala with Toscanini and the La Scala Orchestra. What had happened in June of 51, Toscanini's wife of, let's see, what was it, 1897, of 50, just barely 54 years passed away. And he got very depressed. He kind of like told everybody, I'm not going to conduct anymore. He kind of ensconced himself, I think, at Via Dorini, which was the house he had in Italy. And it was through some cajoling through his son Walter and a few other people that they got EMI to come to record him recording the two Traviata preludes and the Vespri overture. None of it was approved for release, except that I've seen one copy, and it did exist. It was in the Toscanini collection at the library, of a vinyl pressing of on Brazilian Victor of the Prelude Sacks 1 and 3 of Traviata. But that's the only copy I have ever seen of the thing. I'm not sure it was ever issued. I think it was just a test. After these recording sessions, Toscanini believed that he still had the stamina to come back to New York in October, and he did, and conducted for another three seasons. And what the reason why this sounds so good is the fact that in Chris Diamond's new book, Toscanini in Britain, he talks about this recording. They came in and not only did they run tape, but they also ran matrices, hoping, you know, that there was still a 78 RPM market that they could put these things out, as opposed to what RCA was doing at the time, which was running Tinker Toy tapes and dubbing those to 78s, which sounded like garbage. Not that some of their original tapes sounded so hotsy-totsy after what they did to some of them. What I was able to do here was there were some ticks and pops at the beginning that would not come out with the normal processing of Cedar. So I had to go in with a program called Retouch and worked on every one of the incidents in there that would not process properly. And by cleaning it up at the bottom where it had a lot of rumble and also re-equalizing it to get rid of a very nasty edge in the violins at about 2500 hertz, that's the kind of results you can get off of a quiet vinyl disc. This is as close to a original source as you can outside of having the original metal part, but I'll talk about that in a little bit. What I want to do is talk about some restoration procedures that I've done over the years. The next one is from that CD, if you can let me have that. This is a CD that was put out by, what the heck is the name of this? Oh yes, Sunbeam. And it was called Bix Restored. And here's the label of the disc that they sent me. It was an alternate take to a well-known recording called Futuristic Rhythm, which had, Frankie Trumbauer's orchestra, along with Beiderbecke playing trumpet. And by 1929, when they made this record, Beiderbecke was in tatters. He just couldn't play. The issued take had a lot of problems, but there was an unissued alternate take where he played a lot better. The problem is, the only known copy of it was cracked. And there's no metal part to press anything from, meaning it was the only known surviving shellac pressing. So what happens, they contacted me, and this is when I had first gotten retouch and manual declick and dethumping. And what I will play now is what the disc sounded like with the crack in it, and then as you hear it, the restoration I did to it in the short example. Track two, please. Thank you. Now, as one would realize, 78.26 clicks per minute, and the selection runs about 3 minutes. Let's put it this way. They got their money's worth with me working on this, because this is the type of noise that most signal processing in real time or non-real time cannot process, because of the fact that it's a signal that is very, very long and doesn't have a particularly wide frequency response. So most software will not respond to that. It's saying it's music. So what you have to do is you have to go in and manually declick every one of those, and at the same time have to work on the ringing from the cantilever of the cartridge. In other words, there's a residual thump that follows every click because of the way the stylus is bouncing in the groove across that crack. So let's put it this way. You have to take out a click and a thump for every one of those. So start doing the math. Before you know it, you're dealing with several hundred interpolations on this 3 minute side. And toward the end of it, it also had a bad dig in it, so I had a couple of other bad cracks to get out. This was one of the first things I did when some of the software had come out almost 10 years ago. And I'm still kind of pleased the way it sounds. I haven't listened to this in about 6 or 7 years, and I'm pretty pleased with how that was restored, and they were very pleased with it. They gave me a nice little credit in the CD concerning the work on that. That's a rather drastic problem that one will run in where it's, and that's the only source you have. There's nothing else to work with. You've got to put it together. Now we've got something that is one of the most famous records that Benny Goodman made called Bach Goes to Town. This was done for Victor in 1938. And Al, could you play track 3? Okay. What you're hearing there is a problem that Victor had in a lot of their pressings in that period, which was called a gas bubble. That's a little pop going around. It's not as big as the clicks you heard before, but it's just equally as annoying. Now, the trick here is, years ago, we'd have to find another pressing. But this one was so clean, I said, well, let's see if I can clean it up. And this is another one where these are like thumps down in the lower end of the audio spectrum that goes into the music, so it's very difficult to pull these out. But after working on it for a good hour, this is what we got. The next track, please. Years ago, what would we have done on tape, Joe? Run it on reel-to-reel as fast as we could and try to edit it, right? And what would we get? A lot of glips, blumps, and bloop, right, John? You remember, we've all done that, right? Of course, John, you probably came across that with certain tapes in RCA where they try to declick things at 30 inches per second, and then sitting and trying to pull the pieces apart and putting it back together. Right? And then you put it back together and it's like, oh brother. It still has these anomalies because of the fact that when you're listening to a clarinet, which is one of the worst things to try to declick, or a piano, you make any slice into that signal, it will always hiccup, no matter what you do to it. Even digitally. It's very, very difficult because you have to line the signal up properly. It has no vibrato in it. That's what the problem is. Now on to something a little more subtle. Classic recording, the famous Toscanini Barbara Seville Overture from 1929 with the New York Philharmonic. This is one that has given a lot of engineers problems because of the way it stops and starts at the end of side one into side two. Al, and also for the fact, all right, Al, play that please, track 5. As you can hear, it's a bit of a pain in the neck overlap, but that's the way they had to do it. They just could not stop it dead before that note is hit. And, well, with digital editing, it's very easy to crossfade and overlap it. The biggest problem you have is, because of the difference in linear speed from the inside of the disc to the outside of the disc, when the new side starts, the surface noise is much brighter. There's also a certain amount of rumble that's picked up because now you're at the outside of the disc, which may have a little bit of warpage. So because the linear speed is faster, the cantilever is bouncing up and down faster. As a result, as you hear there, it's a little brighter, and you also hear this low-end noise that comes in. The trick is, yeah, you can do the edit, but you have to be able to blend the surface noise and get rid of that rumble at the same time, which can only be done in retouch. And here is the result of what I came up with. This is something that I never thought, when I first got retouched, that I thought I would ever be able to do that kind of a seamless side join. These are all the tools you need, because from what I understand, the original metal parts to those are pretty much worn out because they had made so many pressings of it over the decades. And what happens with a metal part is that when it's pressed too much, it starts to get very fuzzy and dull. And once it goes past a certain point, you can't retrieve it unless you can plate from the original mother or master. And sometimes they played it so many times, that's even worn out. Now we come to one of my favorite little tricks dealing with a restoration, which is a judgment call on the producer and engineer. Those of you who are familiar with record collecting know the famous Victor album M765. What's that? Right, with Toscanini and the NBC. The first thing released from the 39 Beethoven cycle. That lead weight, yeah. That boat anchor. It was considered one of the worst sounding recordings in its period because of the way it was recorded, meaning RCA with its microphone in the wrong spot in 8H and, of course, the instantaneous side breaks because it's a live performance. In 1990, as part of the Toscanini Collection reissue on BMG, for the first time a new source had been used, which we had at the library, which were 16-inch RCA vinylite pressings that were taken off the line, which proved to be in better shape than the NBC discs that were at the Library of Congress, because those had been played to death. Adrian Cosentini and I did at the library. Ward Marston did the remastering. Now, what I'm going to do is play the beginning of this, and for those of you who are not familiar with this recording, you will never forget that you will never forget this recording ever again because it has a trademark noise in it. Track 7. Could you imagine how embarrassed that person was in the audience, stifling a cough and doing it right in the middle of those two pregnant, right in that pregnant pause between
the
two?
Has the person ever been identified?
It sounds like a woman. Well, they're probably long gone. It sounds like a woman if you listen very carefully. It's kind of a high voice. But then, who knows? I have a funny feeling the old man probably would have said, try to get rid of the thing. In fact, I remember when the Japanese put this out on CD back in the 80s, and they were selling at Tower Records for, what, about $20 a disc, John, at that time? You remember those imports? And a friend of mine bought this thing, and I put it on, and I shook my head. They took the first note, clipped out the cough and then added reverb and then went into the second note. That was one way. Another way recently was in a music and arts set where they tried to remove the cough, and what they essentially did is it sounds like a clone of one note on top of another. What I was able to do, just as a test, was I used retouch and I was able to clone the ring out from the second note into the first. Here's the result. Track 8, please. You'll also notice I did a pass of decrackle on it to get all the crackle that was still in there. But as Gary Thalhimer said to me when he heard this back in 2007, he said, "You've just desecrated the American flag. That's the way this recording should be." But for certain purposes, you know, judgment calls, things can be repaired like that. I had played an example of the famous Italiano in Algeri overture that was recorded at Carnegie in 1950. That is loaded with coughs, a door closing, a squeak. It's like everybody must have been trying to get into their seats. And I did a pretty good job with retouch of removing almost all the extraneous noises so that you can actually hear the pizzas at the beginning in a much clearer manner. But of course, if it was put out that way, people would be screaming saying, "Hey, I don't remember it sounding like that." But in certain instances, a judgment can be done to restore something that could not be done in the concert hall because of extraneous problems. Now we come to, those are kind of like relatively easy things that we can restore and retouch. Now comes a real beaut. This is also an original source. Pretty much a 16-inch disc that looks like this, a lacquer-coated disc recorded by the Voice of America in 1950. It was taken off the line from Carnegie Hall and recorded at the studios at the VOA of a concert with Ormandy, Al, your buddy boy, Ormandy, and the Philadelphia Orchestra doing a Sibelius 7th, the premiere of the, what was it, the Virgil Thompson,
Cello
Concerto, and the second half was the Brahms 1st. Well, I started dubbing this, and here's the problem I came across in the Sibelius 7th, track 2, please, 10, please, I'm sorry. No, excuse me, 9. Right. Oh, I feel much better. Okay. Yes, every engineer in this place is now like sitting going, "Oh God, I've heard that before, I've seen that before." Stop it, stop
I've
it, stop it. Stop. Bring it back, cue it to 10, please. For those of you who don't know what that is a ground loop happening. In other words, because a plug was faulty in the patch panel, was loose or fell out for a second and kind of obliterated the signal in that one spot. When I first gave this demonstration back in 2007, I had hit it with retouch and I kind of got it and I wasn't happy because I heard certain artifacts in it. And I tried it again and I said, you know, something, I got to try something else, another trick on this. And this is where sometimes by your first experiments you learn how to fix this. Cedar has a plugin in Sadie called, besides the click, something called the thump, like I spoke about before with the Trombauer, which will remove, you know, a residual low-end thump in a recording very effectively. So I tried it first with what they have different parameters where it says, do you have one cycle of a thump or you can put it up to 100 cycles. So I tried one. It seemed to be effective, but I heard still some artifacts in there. I said, what the heck? Let me bring it up to 5 wavelengths. No, it's let it really process it. And when I looked at the waveform, I was a little bit astonished. And then when I played it back, I was even more astonished at what I got. And with a little bit of retouch, this is what I wound up with, track 10. Can you remember where the hum is? Shall we play track 9 again?
I hear a hiccup.
You hear a hiccup? I don't.
All right, we'll play them together again.
You hear a hiccup?
Okay. Do you guys hear anything back there? Okay. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I worked on that and I thought I had gotten it. Well, I'll go listen to it.
You wouldn't know it if you were, you know, just listening to it normally.
Right, but in the sense of restoring that. At one point, what we would have done was just do an edit, take it out, and the phrase would get truncated. Because that is a very, very long, buzz.
Find that note somewhere else.
In Sibelius? Or find another performance and try to clunk it in.
That's been done.
Oh, yeah. That could take about 4 hours, trying to match the room tone and everything else in equalization. Now, speaking of the Philadelphia Orchestra, there's been a series of classic recordings that never came out on 78s and should have and never did, and then came out on LP and then in two CD incarnations. And it's with this orchestra. And this is an example of, we're going to talk now about metal part transfers. This is part of the famous Death and Transfiguration recording with Toscanini in 1942. That never came out on 78s, was first transferred by John Corbett back in the late 50s, early 60s, up at Riverdale, just as a reference, which then came out in a 5-LP set back in 1976 of all of the known recordings done at that time. Then it was reissued on CD in the Toscanini Collection from those tapes, or copies thereof. And, well, John did the best he could with the pressings he had or the positive metal parts that he was working with. At the time, back in the 50s and 60s, there really wasn't anything to play back what's called known as a biradial stylus, which essentially means you could play the original mother or master or stamper, which is an inverse of a cut record. And what would happen is you'd have to play it backwards, and you would also have to have the cartridge mounted in backwards or an arm that was symmetrical to the one you were using so that you could play the disc in a reverse manner. So John did as best as he could with the equipment he had at the time. And it wasn't terrific, but it was all right. And in 2006, a two CD set came out of it completely remastered from the metal parts.
Four CDs, wasn't it?
Was it four?
It had all the pieces in it.
Oh, so it was four CDs?
I think it was four.
Excuse me. All right, four CDs. This is what a section of the Death and Transfiguration sounded like off the CD. Track 11, please. This room is actually softening some of the problems in that. What you're hearing in there is a transfer done from a metal part that had slightly rusted or deteriorated on the inside. So what you're hearing are all these bumps and thumps and clunks. And in certain instances, an attempt was made to declick it, and there were dropouts in there on top of it. Not only that, the editing between the side is grossly amateurish. It almost sounds like it was done on reel-to-reel tape, the way the surface, the way it stops and starts. Well, after working at it for about 45 minutes, I presented this at ARSCN 2007. There's also something else going on with this. I think in the transfer they had a problem trying to play that part, because when I looked at the scope, I'm looking at the signal bouncing up and down like this, which is indicative of some very low-end garbage going on, or warped metal part, or stylus not tracking, and the cantilever, again, is ringing. So what I was able to do was, first off, I put a low pass in just to get rid of that junk, and all of a sudden the signal is now steady. I ran it past a decrackle to get rid of some of the edge in it, and then spent about 45 minutes cleaning up all the noises and the dropouts. In fact, in one spot I had to borrow part of the signal in one horn, in one note into another, because it was so badly destroyed in the processing where the dropout was, and then smoothing over the surface noise across the side joint. Here's the result. What do you say about something like this? Everything dealing with sources, even as good as they are, will have problems. You have to put the time in to fix it and know what you're doing. I mean, unfortunately, that whole set is riddled with problems like that, especially the side joints, which drive me nuts. They sound like they're done on tape with a razor blade in it. How did it sound back there, guys?
Sounds very good.
Thank you. Any hiccups?
No.
Thank you. Now, on to transferring a metal part properly. As I said before, the master is what is plated off of either the original wax or lacquer, and from that they will make what's called a mold, which is an interim, which looks like a regular disc that can be played with a normal stylus, and from that it's plated again to make a stamper, which has a large hole in the center so that the labels can be inserted, and each half are put into a press. And then with that, the press is pushed together with either vinyl or shellac in it to make a pressing, is what you see here. What I was able to do, and this is back in 1990, was I had to develop a reverse turntable, got the biradial styli, and then also had to figure out a way how to mount my cartridge in backwards and run the wires from the front of the cartridge into the tone arm. Because now it has to go in backwards and then set the offset on the arm the proper way so it has the proper overhang to play the record without destroying it. It took a bit of work, but I was quite pleased with what I got. And here's an example that after 25 years, I'm still pleased with the work I did on this. What you'll hear now is the scherzo from the octet in the orchestral arrangement of Mendelssohn's, done by Toscanini in the NBC Symphony in 8H in, I think it's May of 1945, if I'm correct. And what you'll hear is the original 78, and then see if you can tell me where I edited into the metal part to show you the difference in sound. Thank you. Can you hear where I went into the metal part?
It's a good job.
Thank you.
Very clear. But it sounds better as you go into the metal part.
Pardon me?
It sounds better when you go into the metal part.
Absolutely. Absolutely. First off, you're dealing with post-war shellac that Victor was using. It's also the fact that it's coming off a stamper, which is already two steps away from that metal part I played. Along with the fact that the moment, besides the fact it cleans up, you can hear more room tone, there's a better definition of the bass. That's showing you that the material that they pressed on wasn't particularly good. And this, I have to tell you, this was something when Art Fierro asked me to transfer this, he and Bill Lacey gave me the biggest compliment I had ever gotten in my life. He said to me, he said, you know that Mendelssohn scherzo? I said, yeah. He said, we sent it out for Cedar Rising to get out the clicks and pops. He said, I just head and tailed it. I did absolutely no re-equalization to it. What you gave me in that transfer is on the CD, which I thought was one of the highest compliments I had ever gotten in my career, what I was able to do with a metal part. Now let's make a case for another one, which to the veteran collectors here, the diehards, does anyone remember that awful sounding Hofner Toscanini did in the same period from Studio 3A? Well, let me remind you of what that sounded like. Track 14, please, Al. Was never a good sounding recording. The LP transfers of it were atrocious. In fact, at the very end, the last production tape they did of it, they rolled so much echo into it you couldn't hear what the heck was going on in it. You know what I'm talking about, John. You know, as Victor would keep issuing records, they would put higher stamper numbers on it. And once with Toscanini things, once it went past a certain stamper number, you'd put it on, you wouldn't recognize the original pressing because they would start doing what was called enhanced sound, right? Which meant compression and echo. Well, it's not a great sounding recording, but off the metal part, this is what it sounds like, and this was what was issued on the CD. So it kind of tells you what rotten material these records were pressed on. The difference in sound from the original metal versus the 78. It's still not terrific, but at least you can hear some room tone, as little as there is in that recording to begin with. It was even drier than Studio 8H.
The important thing is that you can hear some of the note values. You could
the note values too. And the other thing that is very interesting about when you work off of metal parts that I discovered, that Art told me that whenever I transferred the negatives or the positives, and we got both playbacks that were very good, we invariably used the negatives. Why? We got a better bass response. Because, think about it, it's a metal part, instead of it being a groove like this, it's like this. The stylus is biradial, it drops in over here. So what's happening is, it's able to get down to the bottom where the lower end frequencies are. No, it's tracked those better. And that's what we found, that invariably, if the negatives were in perfect shape and we can get decent playbacks, that's what we used. And that's what all those two metal parts were from those, that you heard those examples. Now going on to some very annoying problems. One of the things that Joe Patridge and I used to yell about was our great joke about
tapes and discs, what would you used to say? Wow, flutter. And to the new generation of engineers and listeners out there, that has become kind of alien in the digital domain, because Joe said to me, he said, boy, you know when you're playing an old tape or a cassette or a disc that's off center, you could tell the wow and flutter right away as opposed to a digital recording, which does not exhibit any of those problems. Well, part of the Grammy grant that I had to do was to transfer a whole bunch of New York Philharmonic broadcasts during World War II. And Barbara Horst called me up and said, you know, I need you to put together a quick CD set of historic Gershwin broadcasts of what you have, because Gilbert was doing it at the doing an American in Paris about a week or two ago, and they were going to do a lecture on it. I said, all right, let me find what I can get. And in my collection, some of you have heard part of this already, there was a Gershwin concerto done in December of 47 with Oscar Levant and Mitropoulos. And you look at that combination, you figure this is oil and water? Nope. They were of the same mind and they knew what they were doing. And the source I have, which is sitting up here, is from René Snepvanger. He was one of the people that helped develop the modern LP. And this is a microgroove cut lacquer disc, cut inside out. They hold somewhere around, about 18 minutes a side. He was experimenting in his apartment with a couple of cutters and a tuner. And this disc had oxidized very, very badly, and I treated and cleaned it. But one of the results is all the writing on this label disappeared. So what you have to do is you have to make sure that you come up with an archival sleeve that has everything on it, so when you put it back in there, you know what you've got. And what had happened is that I'm making this dub, and this is the problem I came across. Al, would you play the next track?
Certainly.
Thank you. Can you hear what the problem is? I'm not talking about the noises or anything. Remember, this is like an interim, recording. I'm not going to go after everything, but you can hear the wow, the unsteadiness in that recording. And I had meticulously centered that disc. That's one thing I do. If you look on YouTube, there's a video of me playing back a Vitaphone disc, and three quarters of the video is me recentering the disc properly, so there's absolutely no lateral swing of the arm to cause any pitch instability. And this disc is cut inside out. So what happens is, as it's going further out, the linear speed is getting faster. So I'm dubbing this, and it didn't seem noticeable at the beginning. And I've gotten it centered, everything is fine, there's absolutely no swing. And what's interesting about this disc is that I have all the different array of styli. You wouldn't believe it. The only thing that would play this thing back that cleanly was a V15 Type 5 short cartridge with the microwave stylus that came with it. It shouldn't have worked. This was done way before microgroove was perfected. But for some reason, the way Snepvanger was playing the recording or cutting the disc, that was the perfect fit. And I'm listening to this and I'm going, oh great, I've got to get this thing ready. Well, let me see. I'll run it through Respeed I have from Cedar. Then I said, you know, the wow itself is slow enough that it seems to be, it kind of synchronizes with the speed of the disc as it's going around. And the first time, as the old saying, and no comments up there, Joe, teaching an old dog new tricks, I said, you know, let me knock the disc off a certain amount. In other words, get it off center. So, of course, the arm is swinging back and forth, and track 17, this is what I came up with. Thank you. There's still a little bit of pitch instability that could be corrected with software, but it's for what I needed as a demo to get to the Philharmonic, that solved the problem that would have taken me several hours to do digitally. So sometimes you have to look outside of the box or look from the inside out instead of the outside in. That sometimes your procedures that you use all the time will not work. And sometimes you have to do this kind of miscalculation. And for that, I think it was rather effective in getting rid of that problem. Now we come to another thing about getting back to the source, and I have the examples right here. Starting about, I'd say sometime in 1942, the government started issuing V-discs and starting various series of transcription discs, which were dubs of material, or sometimes even originals, if they were, you know, quick to the draw. One of them was the Office of War Information, which I think became the VOA down the road, if I'm correct. And they were stationed here in New York. There was also the V-disc company from the government. These were, you'll have to come up and take a look at this later. This, I'm going to play a bit of this, but this is one. These were the ones sent overseas, and if any soldier was supposed to have stolen one of these, he was supposed to have been, you know, suffered the pain of death, from what I understand. They were supposed to be used for entertainment in the canteens all over Europe for the the armed forces to listen to. In fact, they used to have portable machines, and they used to take it into the field to listen to stuff. But they were all invariably dubs. One of them I'm going to focus in is on a broadcast sponsored by the United States Rubber Company on August 5th, 1945. Starting in the summer of 43, United States Rubber sponsored the New York Philharmonic to broadcast every Sunday when the season ended up until the new season. No subscription concerts, just Sunday. So you get a very interesting array of people coming through. You get William Capell's broadcast debut with the Philharmonic doing a rock second in June of 44 with Reiner. Horowitz appears doing a rock third in April of 44 with Radzinski, among other things. Those are items I've just worked on for the Philharmonic. And one of the things that they couldn't find, which I had in my collection, is this concert from August 5th, 1945 with Dimitri Mitropoulos. And he's doing a program of stuff that he really loves to do. First, it's his own arrangement of the Fantasy and Fugue in G minor, Valse Noble and Sentimentale of Ravel. The second half of the concert, as Al said, is my favorite piece by Darius Milhaud, the Boeuf sur le Toit, the Beef on the Roof, right? And then a Liszt's First Concerto with Alexander Berlovsky. Apparently, the Office of War Information put it out on 16-inch discs. Don't worry, they're vinyl. Hey, the precursor to Dynawarp. Generally, hour and a half concerts were broken at least at the end of a piece or at the end of a movement somewhere, even if they had a slip cue from the original dub. These generally ran over for an hour and a half program, anywhere from 5 to 6 sides, each holding between 12 and 15 minutes. Well,
you say they're micro groove?
No, they're all coarse groove. These are all coarse cut discs. But that doesn't mean you play it with a standard stylus for 78s. These play rather well anywhere between using a 1.5 truncated up to about a 2.3 to about a 2.4 truncated elliptical. Stylus will work on it depending on who cut it, how well it was pressed, the material, and how many times it's been played concerning groove wear and distortion. Well, here's the very beginning of the Mio from this dub. You can hear it's a bit noisy, but what also has happened is that when the solo instruments come in, they're too loud because they've also hit this with a compressor. And the whole thing kind of sounds mushy. Well, fortunately, somehow I wound up with almost 2 complete sets
of the original source, done by Carnegie Hall Recording Corporation. And this is one. This is the disc I use. There's some deterioration on it, which I will clear off. But fortunately, that's during the intermission talk, which didn't affect where I had to take it from. And what this proved was that this was taken off the line and not from Carnegie's own microphone, which had a completely different setup. And that's how certain concerts were recorded that were never broadcast. What you'll hear now is how much quieter it is. There's more definition. It is not a great sounding recording. But you'll also hear how much quieter the instruments are when they come in. And then the most important thing you'll hear is the fact that William Vacchiano is playing that trumpet. He's got that silvery tone that is unmistakable. It's all in the source, folks. It's not terrific, but that's as close as we're going to get after nearly 70, almost 70 years. There are no reference discs from CBS. They did cut discs of this stuff, but their archive was thrown out, and any of the CBS discs that survived, which I will talk about, only survived because that the engineer who cut it saved the material himself. And I'll get into that in a minute. In this series is another recording with Mitropoulos, and this features him as a pianist, not with the New York Phil, but with the NBC Symphony in December of 1945. I want to play you the last movement of the Fifth Brandenburg, where he's at the piano with Misha Mishakov and Carmine Coppola, who is Francis Ford Coppola's father and was Pierre Coppola's son. This was recorded the same way, probably off the line at the VOA, or the Office of War Information, and those discs were then dubbed to these pressings. But since the line was a lot cleaner, you get a result that is a lot better. The only thing was that they only put the music on these discs, and I had another source from an Armed Forces Radio Library disc, which was recorded out in California, where I got the applause and announcements from. So here's an example of what a really great source sounds like, and then what everybody else thought it should have sounded like. Thank you.
Dimitri Mitropoulos at the piano, Mr. Mishakov, concertmaster and violinist, and Carmen Coppola, principal flutist, with the strings of the NBC Symphony Orchestra, have been heard in Bach's Fifth Brandenburg Concerto in D major.
Thank you, Mr. Grauer.
Right,
Mr. Ketter.
Thank you, Mr. Ketter.
It's an inside story.
Yeah.
As you could tell, getting back to the source, where possible. The only source that would be better than what you heard would probably be in the central files of NBC at the Library of Congress on the NBC discs that were cut that day in the studio right below 8H. I think it was 7H where they had the disc cutting room. Now we go on to another dub. As I just showed you before, this V disc of Old California by William Grant Still. It was performed by Monteur with the New York Phil on November 5th, 1944. Here's what the V disc sounded like cleaned up. Essentially, this record's close to a manhole cover, and it's amazing how Cedar was able to remove all the crackle and noise in it. The compression, the pitch instability in it. We decided that we were going to put this piece into the American set with, that was put out by the Philharmonic of Historic Broadcasts back in the late 90s. No, I think it was 2001, that's right. And Sedge the Clark, the producer, said, well, where are you going to find the source to it? I said, I know where the original source to this is. There was a gentleman by the name of Anthony or Tony Yannick who worked at CBS in the network. Radio network division, and he was given the dutiful job of recording broadcasts that came off of CBS, the Blue Network at that time, which became ABC and NBC, onto 16-inch discs, and those discs were to be sent over to the Armed Forces Radio Service in New York Library for them to cut these V discs. Certain instances, they sent the discs back to him after they dubbed it, or they threw them out. He had the presence of mind to take him home and keep him. And it's another, I could do another story about the path of these discs and how they wound up where they did, but their final journey was to UMKC out in Kansas City, Missouri, the Mars Sound Archives, and I know Chuck Haddock's the curator over there. And I called him up, I said, Chuck, do you have these discs? He said, yeah. I said, we'll get a FedEx number to you and ship them to me. And I was able to work off of this, and there was a problem, because at one point someone had hit this with a bad stylus and it was very, very noisy. And I came up with a very narrow stylus, which should not have worked, and got an absolutely clean playback of it. Here's the final result as it appears in the Philharmonic set. An engineer once said, you can always tell how good a recording is. Listen to the applause, because that's the broadband of white noise of the that will give you the frequency response of the recording. It's amazing what happens when you find an original source. But it shows you what kind of a job they did at the V-Disc company or the government. First off, they had a tendency to cut as much as 6 minutes a side. They put out a classical symphony with Toscanini on two sides. So obviously, they're cutting with a very tight pitch, and they are whacking the compressor something fierce. You can hear the difference in there, in the sense of how the whole bottom end is completely whacked out. Side drums only give you a hint of what's going on. There's no solidity down below. And then, of course, the instability in the speed of their cutters, either the cutter recording the disc or the playback of that original disc at the time.
Which was probably canceled out by the instability of the field players.
But yeah, the field players. Very good. Now we come to a very interesting legacy that to us seasoned collectors will never forget. A gentleman by the name of Edward J. Smith. Who remembers him, folks? There you go, Gary. This was a man, as the saying goes, he never met a source he didn't like, never met a surface noise he didn't like, and the expression goes, no expense was spared in putting this production out, and boy, were they right. This was a man that essentially, this is one of the records, this is the one I want to talk about. This is actually one of his better pressings because it was done early on before he really got cheap. This is EJS 181. This is the legendary Otello, the first one the Met had broadcast on February 12, 38. I think it was Gotti Kazadze who originally wanted Martinelli to do it years earlier, and he said, I won't do it until I'm over 50. So February of 38 was the broadcast date for this. Martinelli was nearly 53 at the time, and he is in a magnificent voice. Elizabeth Resberg is the Desdemona, and Lawrence Tibbett is the hideous Iago. And this was one of those things that Eddie put out. It was legendary. Everybody wanted it. The Met, unfortunately, never put it out because it never really sounded good because nobody knew where the original source was. Well, here's an example of what a good Eddie Smith record sounds like. The beginning of the Brindisi with Lawrence Tibbett. And Jeff, who is the Nicholas Massue is the Casio. Here's the very opening of the Brindisi from that LP. For Eddie Smith standards, that's pretty good, considering some of the things he put out, which were usually, as Gary Galo, my friend, says, remastered with a sewing needle and pressed in a waffle iron on reclaimed emery boards. Several years ago, a collector friend of mine called me up. He says, I'm moving. He said, I want you to take all my tapes. And I'm going through things, and all of a sudden, I come across a five or six reels of tape that say this, done by Rock Hill Recordings. Judging from when it was done in the late 50s, early 60s. And it says on it, the broadcast recordings of Lawrence Tibbett, Otello, Act 1 begins February 12, 1938. And I'm going, holy cow. And of course, these tapes were full-track monoacetate on standard slotted reels with splices in them. So that's telling me this is an original tape. This tape was dubbed from the 16-inch disc before they disappeared. Tibbett used to pay to have every one of his broadcasts recorded. Purportedly, it cost him so much that each broadcast he had recorded cost about half the fee he got that afternoon at the Met. A lot of the stuff was supposed to go up to Yale. A lot of it never got there. One of the items that did not get up there was this Otello. So back in 2010, I wound every one of the reels oxide out, cleaned every splice, leadered it, put it on the, slotless reels, and let them sit. And I decided tonight, let me play part of this. Put it up. I have a special playback head that I use, which is a double quarter track head that plays in the center of the tape in case there's any edge curl damage, because these are acetate-based tapes. And getting the pitch right, and what I did, which is should be done on everything, either you put a piece of paper in or mark it on the back, mark the configuration, what you did with it, on what date, and if you know the pitch, put it down there so you know the next time you pull the confounded thing up, you don't have to start guessing where, what speed it plays at. Well, we figured out that this is a dub from the discs that were done by some studio that had a line from NBC. And in many ways, the sound that they got on these discs is superior to what NBC was cutting at the time. In other words, it was a bit quieter. Unfortunately, whoever dubbed this at the time was using some sort of standard stylus that wasn't truncated, so it is a bit noisy. But the proof of the pudding is certain noises you heard in Eddie Smith's recording are on this tape. Here's what the tape sounds after I did a little bit of de-clicking and de-crackling to it, as well as removing a hum from it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie. That was one of his better efforts. By the way, the problem with the source is that after the Ave Maria, the two discs that would conclude the scene are missing. So the reason why I have the set is that if I ever put this together, I'm going to need this turkey to finish out the opera. And where did Eddie get it from? Martinelli had a source, and he dubbed it into the set of discs. So even this source is not complete, but that's all we have. In other words, we have 3.5 acts, and it has all the intermissions, including one with Alistair Cook. So that gives you an idea how far back Mr. Cook goes. Now, that's one of Eddie's better examples. Here's a real turkey. This is the January 21st, 46 Voice of Firestone Trovatore Miserere with Eleanor Stieber and Jussi Bjørling. This is what Eddie put out. The sound, you think World War II hadn't ended yet. It's about a half tone up. It's a really rotten AM off the air, and like I said, Eddie never met a source or a speed he didn't like. In 2010, I remastered a 4-CD set, which is sitting up here, called Jussi Bjørling Live. Thank you, Al. Which was done through the American Jussi Bjørling Society. And we had access to a number of inside sources. One of them was to this, which was off of an NBC glass disc. And I said, finally, we're going to be able to hear this properly. Well, this is what I got. Al, track 28, please. Nothing like a glass-based disc when it's cracked. You know, as Max Bialystok said in The Producers, how did the crazies find me? They all find me. I sit there sometimes wondering, how do these sources find me? They all find me. This is another one where I had to sit there and de-click it, and it ran about almost six minutes. And it's also a problem because of the fact that this is running at a slower speed. It's much harder to de-click because it's going at a slower speed. There's more space there. In other words, there's more time involved. So it took a lot of de-clicking and de-thumping, and then in retouch, sometimes repairing some of the sustained passages, which would hiccup after everything was done. Here's the result that was put on the CD.
Oh.
it was worth the effort. Listening to probably one of the most beautiful tenors of the 20th century. I wish we had singers like that around today, including the soprano. Now, as the old joke goes in Jewish business, Monday we had a rotten day. We only sold one suit. Tuesday was even worse. We sold nothing. Wednesday was even worse. What could be worse? The suit we sold on Monday came back. Why do I say this? What could be worse than an Eddie Smith LP? Does anyone remember something called MDP? We made a joke. We used to call the most deplorable performances. This guy was the first one in the LP era was copying Eddie Smith LPs. That's pretty bad. I mean, that's, as the saying goes, he who copies my junk gets junk. And one of the items he put out was a two LP set of Bjerling Live. And a lot of it was copied from Eddie Smith stuff that had been around. But on there was reportedly a broadcast that said from paper tape from 1948 New York that nobody had ever seen before, Bjerling singing Swedish songs from a concert in Carnegie Hall. What we finally figured out is after the discographies came out, it was from a concert called Sweden and Music broadcast over NYC in April of 49. And they said it was done on paper tape. From about 1946 to about 1950, the first forms of tape were not acetate-based. They were paper, and they were rather noisy. Plus the fact if you didn't have good equipment, this is the kind of result you got.
I will sing for you a Swedish song, The Maiden Under the Linden Tree, by Wilhelm Petersson Berger.
Lovely, isn't it? Diffused, compressed, it's about a half tone sharp. And the distortion in there is almost reminiscent of a bad soundtrack from an old film that wasn't copied properly. Luckily, through the Bjerling Society, they located a collector in Sweden who had a set of discs on Rock Hill Studios, 78 RPMs, which were dubs from some sort of 16-inch set of discs that was taken off the line. So this is as close to the source as we'll ever come to it. And it does have its problems, but here's the difference.
I will sing for you a Swedish song, The Maiden Under the Linden Tree, by Wilhelm Petersson Berger.
Oh. And speaking of paper tape in this period, one of the prized performances that a lot of conductor collectors looked for years ago was a performance given as the last concert of the 47-48 season by the New York Philharmonic under the direction of Bruno Walter, the only occasion when he broadcast the complete Missa Solemnis of Beethoven. The cast included Eleanor Stieber, Nan Merriman, William Hain, and Lorenzo Alvari. Well, we knew of a source of this that used to float around the Good Sound Associates. Remember that one, John? Which was off of paper tape that was pretty much unlistenable. But it never got as bad until it finally came out a few years after that in the 80s. Do we remember this little turkey? That came from Italy. That came into Tower Records, and we were paying, what, about $20, $25 a set for these things. And it's a dub from that same paper tape with all sorts of pitch instabilities, little edits in it, pieces missing, and...
Is that the source of the AS disc CD?
Probably. It's probably the same source because nobody else could find anything on it. Well, here's the beginning of the Gloria. Hold on to your hats, folks. By the way, the Kyrie was in E-flat when I played the disc. This thing was approximating somewhere in D major, I think. I was just absolutely shocked when it went from one thing into the other and the pitch just went whoop. That's typical of what a lot of the pirates did, especially what was coming out of Italy. Fortunately, I have not one, but two original sources. First, let's hear Rene Snepvanger's FM Off the Air of it done at 33 and a third, which I have here. There was a glitch there, but that was the Snepvanger. What it's showing is that on that rotten LP, because of the compression, that diminuendo that Walter wanted at the beginning was completely destroyed. You couldn't tell that. In other words, because of the way the dynamics were compressed. It's not a bad source, but now I have another one. This one was cut by Mary Howard, who had lines from the networks. She became an engineer during World War II when there was a shortage of engineers because they were all drafted. In fact, she went into a studio and demanded to learn how to do this material. And she was in demand anywhere from about 1942 right into the 50s because she did very good work and she maintained her equipment unlike other studios at the time. Here's what Mary Howard's source sounds like, which is at 70 RPM versus the Schnepfanger, which was 33 and a third. There's a little bit more internal clarity in the Mary Howard. There's a little better bass response, I think. Overall, if I was going to do a transfer, I would be using the Mary Howard disc because the overall frequency response and dynamic range, which I think is a little wider than the FM off the air. But this is where all of a sudden I have now a plenty of sources. In certain reel-to-reel sources, I have a Philharmonic material. I've counted three or four original FM off the airs that do not exist in CBS line checks or at the Voice of America. It's amazing how many people by the 50s started recording things and were able to hold on to them, and they were rather decent dubs. Now here comes a real fun one. This is one that has never really turned up in great sound. March 11th, 51, a Sibelius concerto with Yasha Heifetz and Dimitri Mitropoulos. What's crazy about this season was this is the one season that CBS decided to record the broadcast 1 week, edit it with Jim Fassett announcing it, and delay broadcast it the next week. So what you heard on the air was a tape dub already that had been edited, but they did a pretty good job of it. In a collection I got that was pretty much unmarked, I figured out what the heck it was, and this was done, I think, on a MagnaCord tape recorder of the period that ran at 15 inches per second. The sound is terrific. Of course, it's also a center channel tape, and that special head I had made up played it perfectly. The only problem was the tension on it went screwy. At the beginning of the third movement, I had to play it down about 5%, which is quite a bit. By the middle of the movement, it had creeped down to about 6%, and toward the end, it was over 7% down from 15 inches per second. Well, after chasing it and watching everything, this is the result I got. Thank you. That's the cutoff, what the recorders did. Well, last selection I want to play. Al, could you hand me the two Valter CDs? Get to those. Was something I was very proud of. I played this at the local AES chapter. I consider it probably the greatest recording of the Mahler Fifth. It was the first one ever done, Valter and the New York Phil, in Carnegie Hall in February of 47, which we found out later they ran and did at Carnegie that day because there was a subway strike. So the IND wasn't rumbling through and they could take takes as much as they wanted to during the day. And in the Masterworks Heritage, actually it wasn't that, it was for the Bruno Valter edition, Dennis Rooney contracted me to transfer the original lacquer discs, which were very, very problematic. They had been played to death to dub 78s, and then to make a production tape, LP production tape for the LP issue in the early 50s. And we had problems, but we surmounted them. And this is going back to the source in many ways, and it's quite remarkable in comparison to the first issue of it on the Masterworks Portrait series. And this kind of right opaque picture of Bruno Valter on the cover kind of reflects the transfer, which was obviously done from the LP production tapes, never going back to the discs. And what I've done here is essentially done another one of those edits. See if you can hear where the original portrait ends and the transfer Dennis and I did 20 years ago begins. That's it, folks. What you've seen is over 30 years of working at this material, and what I can tell you is every one of these things that I've worked on takes time and effort, but you also have to have the proper tools and know how to use them. Edison said anything that happens is 10% inspiration, 90% perspiration. I agree with him. And getting a proper remastering, 90% of it is being able to retrieve it from the analog domain properly. And the rest of it is a piece of cake. Because once you put garbage into a computer, you're going to get more garbage out. And as we've heard tonight of some of the instances of where things were not done properly. So thank you. And if you have any questions, I'm here to answer them. Any thoughts, anything you heard that you liked, you didn't hear, I'm just curious.
Where was the cutoff in the Mahler?
Mahler? At the cymbal crash.
Cymbal crash.
Cymbal crash. In fact, you can actually hear in that tape. That's right.
Slight pitch change.
That's right, because in this CD, because they used the LP production master, the pitch was sagging all over the place, and they never corrected it. And it happened, Dennis told me when he went to check it, was that the pitch always sagged just as they were doing the side joints where they were doing slip cues because both machines were running and the electricity wasn't well regulated, so both cutters would drop in speed just a little bit as they were doing the slip cues. And I think the turntable they were playing it back was running a little slow and no one checked it. Doug Pomeroy mentioned it, that when he started working at Columbia back in the late 60s, early 70s, they had no equipment for variable speed. No, it's turntables, tape recorders. Dub it. Whatever the speed is, that's it. We're putting it out. So is it any wonder that that thing was such a mess?
They were using Gates broadcast tables.
Gates broadcast tables?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, weren't there also Empire ones, too, earlier on?
Well, these are the 16-inch tables.
The 16s, yeah. I remember seeing RCA transcription ones in some radio stations. Also, no speed correction.
At Columbia.
Oh, they did, okay.
At Columbia, yeah I saw those.
Right. Paul, you got good ears. I heard that too when I slapped it together. I said, I got to do this just to show how the thing was.
I missed it completely.
Was that?
I was so intent on how the performance was going.
Well, it was interesting. Al heard some of the tests we did 20 years ago, you know, from the lacquers. And what did you say at the time? Come over here.
I didn't realize how tight the performance was. And how exciting. And Walter was known as being very lyrical and sweet and soft. This is a very tough performance.
And you said it puts a new light on it, that it gives a completely different light on what this performance was, that when Dennis did some of the press releases for these releases, he quoted you on that, concerning how astonishing the new transfer was.
I'll make a note of that.
Okay, good. Feed me. Any other questions? Yes, John?
Two things. First,
yeah.
RCA was the same as Columbia. They didn't have variable speed for either tape or disc.
Yeah.
Period. The other thing is that one thing you didn't mention, and I think it's important to mention,
yeah,
is that when you do a transfer well, you can often, Al alluded to this, you can often hear subtleties in the performance that are completely lost.
That's right.
In the sound score.
That's right.
And this is a very important point. It's not only that it's more enjoyable to listen to, but you suddenly sometimes go, aha, that's what the artist was trying to do.
Exactly. Exactly. Certain subtleties that the artist wanted to hear that they couldn't hear at the time because of the limitations of the recording itself or the playback or the listening, the playback system or the equipment they were playing it on.
Yes,
yes, Jeff.
You could hear the stage noises of Tibbett clanking his beer mugs with the other...
And the moving around, yeah. In fact, in one spot too, you can hear in the tape some low-end noises, which I'm not sure was either thumping as someone hit the cutting table or in the playback. It's on the Eddie Smith records. That same thumping's there, but it's much more apparent on the tape. It's much clearer. And certain noises that on Eddie Smith sounds like transmission noises aren't transmission noises. They're actually scratches. No, it's because of the poor stylus match to the disc, which may not have been cleaned properly at the time. Remember, this is a transfer that's probably as old as I am, and boy, that's old. You know, probably from the late 50s already. Any other questions, folks? Yes, Gary.
Thank you for dropping the penny on the Coppola connection.
Oh, well, you're welcome.
I didn't know that Piero was related to
the... It's the father of Carmine. And Carmine is the father of Francis Ford. Quite a lineage. I can never remember who is the flautist at the end of the NBC. The beginning was
Arthur Laura?
Arthur Laura, that's right. Yes, yes, yes. And Paolo Renzi's son, Paul Renzi Jr., I think, was the second flautist.
Yeah, who retired from San Francisco just a few years
ago.
Yeah.
It's actually a little bit shocking if you think about it, folks. There are essentially one or two old-timers from the whole NBC Symphony left. One of them is Ray Corsara, who's still around, who's in his late 80s. But they're all pretty much gone now. Time flies. Any other questions?
Incidentally,
yes.
I was at that Metropolis Rubber concert.
Oh, in August of 45.
Yeah.
Was Carnegie Hall as hot as it was because it wasn't air-conditioned at that time? That was August of...
Nothing was air-conditioned at that time. That'd be what it was.
But you can tell from the programming of this, this is something where they called him in and said, all right, program, and he says, I'm going to do the pieces I want to do. And you can tell he really loves doing that.
The meal were terrific.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I haven't gotten to the Liszt concerto. I can hardly wait to hear what Mr. Berlovsky does.
Better than above suspicion.
Better than above? You mean you get some of the notes, huh? Okay. They liked them at the Philharmonic. They kept calling him every year. There are a number of broadcasts. We're talking about Alexander Berlovsky, who is not exactly known for his accuracy for some reason. Anyway, any other questions, folks? No? Okay, well, thank you very much, and I hope you enjoyed it. I enjoyed doing it. And by the way, this is an experiment. This whole thing has been recorded digitally, and we're going to be sending this over to the ARSC website. This will be one of four programs for the remaining part of the season that hopefully we will get over there, and it will be streamed so that if you're a member, you can watch this, if you so choose. And don't forget, our next meeting is going to be Tom Fine on February 20th. Hope to see you then.